Welcome to Sound of Spurs podcast presented by HEB. This is episode number 7, and we're very pleased to be joined by Terry Porter, 17 years in the NBA, two-time All-Star, had some great years with the Portland Trailblazers. He's number 30, is retired by the Portland Trailblazers. He spent his last 3 years as a player with the San Antonio Spurs and a lot of stuff since then, so we'll get to that. But Terry, very good to see you. A proud son of the city of Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
That's right. Bill, great to be with you. And Yeah, proud to say that Milwaukee is where I started my basketball career and played little dribblers, and it's all started there.
Now, we hear about these legendary playgrounds in Chicago and Philly and New York. Milwaukee is not too far from Chicago, and some good players have come out of Milwaukee.
Yeah, we've been blessed to have some great players over the years come from Milwaukee. Fred Brown, downtown Freddie Brown. When you go old school and Latrell Sprewell, myself, and current guys. Golden State Warriors have two guys, Poole and Moody are two guys from Milwaukee as well. So we sprinkle a little bit some guys in there, but it's been a pretty good basketball spot.
And of course, Marquette University has had a great basketball tradition right there in Milwaukee.
Yes, the University of Marquette has some obviously great coaches, but great players who've gone on and wore the Marquette uniform and gone on to play in the NBA. Maurice Lucas, I think Doc Rivers, and so Jones. So there've been some great. Great programs in Wisconsin, and Marquette's obviously been one of the better universities.
I go back to those jerseys worn on the outside, Jerome Whitehead, I think.
Right. Those were some classic jerseys. Those were the early days, and they really be the first university to kind of, spread out a little bit, went out of their way to kind of get more fancy and not the traditional, just tuck them in. And I think it was something that the fans really enjoyed.
And when you were a kid, the Milwaukee Bucks came of age. Lou Alcindor, later known as Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, the Big O, Oscar Robertson. I'm trying to remember some of the guys on that team, but those guys were really, really good ball club.
Well, yeah, those were my early days, and my brother and my dad introduced me to professional basketball and got a chance, like you said, to see the Big O and Bob Dandridge and some of those guys. Obviously, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, Lou Alcindor back then. So, those are the early days of the NBA when it was just kind of starting to find its way.
So when did you find your basketball roots? When did you say, hey, I want to really make this my passion?
Well, I think as a kid, I grew up playing basketball. I grew up playing a lot of sports. As a kid, you grew up, we played our big sports in our neighborhood was football during the winter, and basketball in the summer. And then obviously play a little baseball in the summer as well. But seriously, when I start getting really sad, I guess high school years and then college years is when I start playing and practicing a lot more and really just trying to, first from the high school years, trying to get a scholarship or trying to get an opportunity to play at the college level. And then from college, I had went to a small school, NAIA school, Stevens Point, which is about 2 hours north of Milwaukee. And I didn't know about my potential in the NBA until later. 1984, but it's been a great journey and a very surprising journey along the way.
It's a small school, but very well known for their basketball tradition. And of course, Dick Bennett, a legendary coach, was your college coach. What was that recruitment like?
Well, it was interesting. So, Dick Bennett was at what you would call. We were at a state. We're trying to get to state, and so we were in the regionals bracket. And Dick Bennett actually was there to see another kid on the other team. And so, funny story, his wife is the one who identified me as gave him a little elbow. I learned later that she gave him a little elbow and said, you need to start looking at that number 30 and start paying attention to the other number 30. And I was the other number 30. So we joke a lot when we get together, his wife and I, about she giving him the best two players he ever had. And that's his son, Tony Bennett,
right,
who's now coaching at the University of Virginia. He coached him at the years at Green Bay, and then obviously myself. So we always say she's got the eye for talent in the family.
Well, it was good for you to kind of latch on to that Bennett family at that point because obviously it was still very early, and he went on to great things as well. So you have a great career at Wisconsin Stevens Point. You get to the NAIA Finals. Right. That must have been a heartbreaking loss. What do you remember about that game? Fort Hays State beat you in the finals, right?
Yeah. Obviously, the losses stick with you longer than the wins do. And for us to represent our conference and represent our state and make it to the national championship, it was an unbelievable experience. And like you said, it was disappointing that we lost. And it was a very competitive game. Fort Hays State was a local university. Mm-hmm. Right there in Kansas City, and we just didn't make the plays at the end of the game. But, no, it was very competitive, and one of my better stretches of playing professional, amateur basketball.
There must have been a few scouts there watching you play, because you were the only NAIA player to be invited to the Olympic trials with all these big-time Division I guys. Did that give you a boost of confidence at that point? Like, hey, I can play with these big school guys?
That gave me a huge boost, and it kind of gave me my first kind of, indication that I may have an opportunity to get played in the NBA. Back then, again, to educate your viewers, back then they had about nine rounds. They just have two now. So I knew I was going to get drafted. So funny story about the 1984 Olympic trial. So 1984, it was going to be in L.A. Bobby Knight was the coach. You had mentioned earlier that I was the first NAIA player ever at that time invited to Olympic trials. There's the head of the NAIA on a national level is the gentleman who called the selective committee every day and tried to say, look, it's time for you guys to really have an opportunity to invite at least one NAIA player. And I was blessed that I was the one guy that he identified, and I was able to go to the Olympic trials with 90 other collegiate players at the time. And I made the first cut, made the second cut, and then I got the chicken pox, believe it or not.
Wow.
Caught the chicken pox and had to go back to Stevens Point. And everybody had their opinion on Bobby Knight. They're either hot or cold on Bobby Knight. But the way he handled my situation was something I always have much respect for him. He told me, hey, you deserve a right to try to compete for this position and represent your USA in Olympic trials. I went back after a week of recovering from the chicken pox, and I got cut. And your audience may remember two other names that I got cut with, shared the van with. One by the name of John Stockton, other name by Charles Barkley. The three of us rode a van together to the airport with the last cut before they made the Olympic trials.
And, of course, this is before the NBA allowed players or the Olympics allowed NBA players, so it was truly a kind of an all-star college team.
Yeah, it was a legitimate collegiate team and legitimate talent from the college level. You didn't have any pros. You couldn't even have any pros that played overseas and came back. So it was, I think it was the second to last time, like you said before, because I think the dream team was 90. So, yeah, it was second to last time before they start allowing professional basketball players to compete.
This is Sound of Spurs podcast, so we want to get to your time with the Spurs, but we can't skip your time in Portland. You get drafted in the first round by the Trailblazers. You go to a whole new place, yeah. Whole different world for you, I'm sure.
Exactly.
Yet, immediately, you become a Trailblazer.
Well, yeah. Well, I was blessed to, get drafted by the Portland Trailblazers. Their scouting team, Stu Inman and Bucky Buckwalter and the rest of their staff recognized me in all those amateur competitive events that the NBA goes scouts and prepare for the draft. And so I got drafted there, had Darnell Valentine as a veteran there who really helped me, talked me a lot about being a pro. Stevie Coulter, who another veteran who really talked me and schooled me a lot about what it was like to be in the league. And then I was fortunate and blessed to have some great coaches. I had Jack Ramsey as my first coach, taught me a lot about, again, how to eat as a professional, how to take care of my body. And then Rick Adelman, who was unbelievable. Mike Shuler, who was a great coach. And so just fortunate and very blessed to have a lot of great coaches. PJ Colissimo was one of my coaches there in my stint. And
you learned Italian food from him.
That's right, Italian food and how to cuss.
You know him, don't you?
But no, it was a great experience, and we were able to, have some great teams and make some great runs. Two, like you mentioned, two NBA finals, and came up a little short nosed. But no, it was unbelievable experience for me those first 2 years, and to really be able to play at such a high level.
When people look back at your time in San Antonio, because you came to the Spurs late in your career, you were 36, 37 years old at the time, and you ended up being the point guard, I guess, between Avery Johnson and Tony Parker during that 3-year stint.
Well, Tony, yeah, I think Avery, and then it was me, and then Tony was actually here when I was here. So Tony was, 19, I was 36. They used to call, so it was TP, me, and then TP Jr. So Tony was considered junior, and I just knew he was going to be good. Obviously, his speed was the first thing that you noticed right away when he got on the basketball court. His ability to go to one end of the floor to the other end, and really had a great passion for the game. And obviously, his dad, who he learned a lot from, who played over in Spain, obviously taught him a lot about the American game and how to compete.
Well, you know, it's interesting because when he first came, you know, he's a slight little kid. He looked like a kid. He had that baby face and everything. As you know, he got that toughness, and I think, you know, Pop obviously was tough on him at first, you know, trying to groom him to be a good NBA player. But we saw Tony kind of grow up right in front of us that first year.
Oh, no question. I think Pop realized his potential, and Pop was really hard on point guards. I think anybody who played that position for Coach is always something that he demands a lot of knowledge and some spunk and some ability to compete. And Tony had all those skills. You could tell that early on. I've seen enough of his back that he went running past me in practice to know that he was going to be good. But, no, I just loved the way he competed and the way he always talked to me about just the league, my years in the league, my years in the playoffs, my years in making it to the finals, what that was like. And he just always wanted to know more and more about the position and about the league.
And, of course, you got to share the court with two other Hall of Famers, Tim Duncan and David Robinson. Just a few moments to talk about those guys and your first impressions of them. Of course, you went against them for years as an opponent, and now you're teammates all of a sudden with them.
Well, I mean, I obviously start with David. David, we battled in the Western Conference Finals when Larry Brown was the head coach and Pop was the assistant coach. And those Spurs, earlier Spurs teams that had Sean Elliott was on that team as a starter, and they had Terry Cummins, and they had obviously David. And so it was a very competitive head to head. But what I loved about David was his ability just to impact the game in so many ways. I mean, his speed, you didn't see that in a big guy. He was just as fast as a guard, and his ability to block shots and run the floor and figure out how to score was something that you just didn't see in a 7-footer back then. He was way ahead of his time.
Yep. And, of course, the big fundamental, Tim Duncan, who probably would have been, Terry, I think maybe the number one pick had he come out after his junior year, and he decides to come out after his senior year. Of course, he's the number one pick. Spurs got a nice little bounce there, right? I mean, that was a pretty fortunate bounce for the Spurs. And they'll tell you right up front, you know, it was pretty fortunate to be able to pair Duncan and Robinson together. But Tim seemed like he was very mature when he got to the league.
I think that's one of the things you noticed right away when Timmy first got in. He was very calm, very professional about how he went about his craft, how he went about preparing every day and practice and how he worked on his body that needed work. And he just got better and better. And, anybody who's at that level, who's that great, he always had an inner drive. Timmy, I would say more introvert. He wasn't one that he'd have all his emotions lay out on his sleeve. But he had a fire in his belly that was just as strong as anybody else, and he wanted to win. He loved to compete.
My first year with the Spurs, I was just trying to take it all in, and you guys had such a good spirit about you. And one of the guys who was always kind of involved in the hijinks was Malik Rose.
Yeah.
How do you like having Malik as a teammate?
Malik was great. I mean, he was very emotional, yelling, screaming. You know, us older guys or more veteran guys, you know, we're kind of quiet. But we need those young guys' energy and a spark. And, you know, he would be running around all the time, patting guys on the back and, telling them pick it up. And, just a great amount of energy you needed in practice and more in the games and on the bench.
When you look back at your 3 years as a Spur, as a player, what are your fondest memories?
Well, just having a chance to compete. I think the players themselves, people don't realize the Spurs were the golden standard back then. I mean, their culture, the way Pop invited guys in, the way he really embraced guys, the way this community embraced people who put on the silver and black, and those are the things that I take along with me. Obviously, the players, Avery Johnson, who a very good friend of ours, dear friend of our family, all the many guys, Steve Kerr, Danny Ferry, I mean, David 5-0, and like you said, Mr. Fundamental. So those relationships, when you get onto a battle and you're able to compete at such a high level, those relationships are substantial and long-lasting.
It's the 50th anniversary of the franchise, and if you can take yourself out of that equation for the 3 years you played, when you look at what the Spurs' legacy is in 50 years in this league, and, of course, the time spent in the ABA, because the first few years of this franchise, they were in the old ABA, which is fun and unique, what would you say the legacy of the Spurs is?
Well, champions. I mean, I think, even for the earlier days, they had unbelievable players. Think about the Iceman and the ABA days. More, you think about guys who were just game changers, Art Gilmore, Artis Gilmore. I mean, so you go from the ABA days to, obviously, into the merge into the NBA and the standard they set and their ability to really become a golden standard. A lot of teams tried to copycat. This is a copycat league, as you know. A lot of tried to copycat their culture and just how Pop and Peter Holt really allowed to mend the team and bring in the type of players that fit this community and fit that organization.
And you certainly were one that fit right in. You're certainly a big part of the community when you were here. You went into coaching after your playing career. Your last 3 years as a player was with the Spurs. And I know you got a degree in communications from Wisconsin Stevens Point. I was kidding with you about this earlier. And radio television was part of that. So did you think, at least for a moment before you got into coaching, about maybe getting into television or radio?
Yeah, I did. I mean, my last year with the Spurs, I started talking to friends that I knew who was in radio and TV, and talk to people I know about coaching as well at the collegiate level, as well at the pro level, and just tried to, you know, have coffee with them or meet down and have lunch with them and talked about the pros and cons of both of those professions. And I just had an opportunity to go out to Sacramento and rejoin Rick Adelman and Jeff Petrie, who was part of the Portland process when I was there, and just felt – it just felt good to be able to reconnect with those guys.
Was Pete Carrillo on that staff, the old Princeton coach?
Yes, he was. Backdoor Pete.
Well, Terry, I grew up in the Palestra in Philly, right? So Penn and Princeton, that was a big, big deal back in the day when the Ivy League was really good. And, of course, Pete Carrillo just, you know, talk about fundamentally sound and know how to play defense as well.
Pete was an amazing, amazing basketball IQ. Just one of those guys who mindset and just knowledge of basketball was across all generations, and he could teach anything to anybody, no matter what the age separation was. He just knew how to get in the young man's mind and talk about the game and bring it to a point where they really could enjoy it and then enhance it themselves.
When you got a chance to be a coach yourself, first an assistant, then as a head coach, did you find yourself taking a little bit from each of the coaches and each of the experiences that you had from different guys like Dr. Jack and Pop? I mean, you've played, obviously, for some very – Rick Adelman, some very good coaches.
Yeah, I mean, I was – like you said, I've been blessed to be coached by a lot of Hall of Fame coaches. And you try to take a little bit from each one and try to blend it in with your own personal beliefs and your own – you know, missions and what you think is important. And a lot of times it's the same thing. I was blessed to be on a lot of good teams, and a lot of it had to do with always having a good culture, always bringing in the right players, always having players that you think have good basketball IQs and want to compete. I mean, I think that's a thing that you always try to look for as you try to evaluate guys to try to be a part of a franchise, to try to go on and try to win a championship.
And, of course, you continued coaching at both the collegiate level and the professional level. And as you picked up different things along the way, I know some of it had to be one of those situations where you look back and say, you know what, I got that from Rick Adelman, or I got that from a guy that I played with maybe. Yeah. Just different things. And that's the great thing about experience, 17 years as a player, all those years as a coach.
Well, yeah, I mean, as you acknowledge, you know, so much of what you learn is about your experiences and under those particular coaches that you were able to say you liked, you didn't like. And I was blessed to kind of, you know, think about the way I wanted to play, the way I want to coach, and really learn from a lot of the guys that I was able to play for.
Now, at this point in your career, you're taking a little sabbatical right now. I ran into you in Portland. a few weeks ago, and you're just kind of chilling right now. So bring us up to date on what Terry Porter's up to these days.
Yeah, I'm still relaxing a little bit, doing some things. I've been in some talks with some people. I'm probably going to do something here pretty soon, but that hasn't been announced yet. But, no, excited about, you know, what the future has. And I'm trying to stay close to basketball. I think that's the area where I really can, again, lend my experience and really be valuable to our organization.
Now, you're still back out in the Pacific Northwest, is that right, in the Portland area?
That is correct. I'm still living in Portland.
Is Seattle ever going to get a team, Terry?
I hope they do. I mean, obviously, being a part of those great I-5 rivalries, it's like, you know, having San Antonio and Houston, right? You can't, you know, deny those rivalries and just the nature of just being so close that you want to have that team represented, that city represented, because it was such a great rivalry back in the day. And you talk about some of the great teams that have been a part of that franchise and the championships they've had along the way. So you hope that the NBA would embrace that community again and really bring back that that franchise.
Terry Porter, thanks so much for joining us for Sound of Spurs. Wouldn't be the same without you. It was great to have you, and best of luck in your future. Okay.
Well, thank you so much. Great to be with you.
Okay, episode number 7, former Spur Terry Porter, 3 years with the Spurs late in his career, and we'll take a break, and we'll have more Sound of Spurs coming up next week. Surprise guest coming up.